morning. As Dan said, today we are kicking off our Easter series. So we're starting today and it's going to lead us right up to Good Friday and to our Easter Sunday morning celebration, which you don't want to miss. Get it in your diary. So Lent is this season that's celebrated all around the world by loads of Christians. And the idea is it's 40 days in the run-up to Easter Sunday. And the point is to make space in your life, to make space to focus on what Easter means and what Jesus has done for us. And people, they fast things to do this. So they will maybe fast like fun foods, or maybe they'll fast fun things. But the idea is that it prepares you and it gives you time. And if I'm being completely honest, I kind of find Lent, I approach it quite half-heartedly. Sometimes I'm like, oh, will I do it? Will I not? And I find that my motivation to give things up is quite selfish. Like, oh, I'll give up chocolate because then I'll be skinnier and holier. And what we're reading today is where the concept of Lent is biblically based. It's from the first book in the New Testament. It's called Matthew. And we're going to look at Jesus, who's in the wilderness. He's been there for 40 days and 40 nights fasting. And then the devil joins him. Let's read it together. It's Matthew 4, verses 1 to 11. It's on the screen. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, 'Man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God.'" Then the devil took him to the holy city and made him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down. For it is written, 'He will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against the stone.'" Jesus answered him, "It is written, 'Do not put the Lord your God to the test.'" And then again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. "All this I will give to you," he said, "if you bow down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, 'Worship the Lord your God and serve him only.'" Then the devil left him, and the angels came and attended him. One of my goals in life was to marry someone with a really good surname, because I grew up being a MacReady, which is very Irish, and that's okay. People can generally pronounce MacReady. But I wanted something strong and like user-friendly, like Smith or Brown. This was not to be. I married someone and I now have the surname Mcilrath. Yeah. And I had to change it on my passport, and I had to do it about 2 months in advance of our wedding because we were flying back to Malaysia straight after. So I had this funny limbo, 2 months of sort of being a Mcilrath but not having a valid passport. I thought, is this like, can I change my Gmail username now to my new surname, or am I not official? And so my identity was unsure. I was almost a wife, almost a Mcilrath, until the day of our wedding. And we said our vows, and we danced, and we ate loads of food. And then it was announced to all our family and friends, introducing, for the first time, Mr. and Mrs. Mcilrath. Finally, my identity was confirmed. Our passage today has a prequel and a sequel. Before what we've just read, Jesus is at his baptisms and his identity is publicly confirmed. God says, "That's my son, I love him, and I'm really pleased with him." And then we read our passage, which is Jesus in the wilderness. But straight after that, Jesus starts his earthly ministry. And then these are these two incredible bookends to this difficult testing time in between. Why? Why, after this incredible moment of his identity being publicly confirmed, did Jesus have to go through this testing time and why just before he was going to start this incredible ministry did he have to endure this alone. Have you ever noticed that the Christian life comes with battles and blessings, that no good thing goes uncontested? Jesus has an incredible high at his baptism, and then he's led into the wilderness, he's fasting, and then bam, attack, opposition. The Bible speaks of a personal enemy of us called the devil. Now, he's not equal to God, but he does work against God's people. And we are told that his purpose is to kill, to steal, and destroy. And that is what he's trying to do to Jesus here in the wilderness. And we, across the three temptations we just read, we can see that he's got all these like tactics and strategies to try and trick Jesus into failing in his ministry. But the first thing I want to talk about and I want to mention, so he's hungry, he's in the desert for 40 days, 40 nights, and verse 2 says, he was hungry. Hungry. 40 days and 40 nights without food. Like, I can barely go 2 hours without eating anything. Hungry. Have you, do you know this word, hangry? Has anyone heard of that? When you're like hungry, angry, oh, it's the worst. You know when you're in meetings all morning and you know you're in meetings all afternoon and that one highlight of the day is lunch and you've known what you want to eat from like 10 a.m., but then it takes like 15 minutes to round everyone up and then get them to the restaurant and then everyone sits down. Oh no, it's too cold here for the aircon. Oh, let's move to another seat. And then they want like take ages to go through the menu and you've known what you wanted the whole time and you're so hungry and you find yourself and you find your threshold to be kind and gracious to your colleagues getting thinner and thinner the hungrier you get. That's what hangry is. And this is exactly when the devil tempts Jesus. Temptation number one. Take a look at verses 3 and 4. The tempter came to him and said, if you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread. Jesus answered, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Jesus hasn't eaten for 40 days. Why can't he use his power to create some food? Is it a sin for him to eat? Why doesn't he just turn the stones into bread? With this first temptation, I don't think it's about the bread, okay? Bread is good, carbs are good. But the devil shows up, he takes a good thing, he tempts Jesus in a moment of weakness and of vulnerability to take things into his own hands and provide for himself. The devil wants Jesus to question his relationship with God, to doubt his identity. So he taunts him. He says, if you are the Son of God. And the temptation for Jesus was to provide for himself and not rely on the Father. And there's nothing wrong with the miraculous. We see it later on. Jesus, he turns water into wine. He multiplies the fish and the loaves to feed thousands. But here, the devil wants him to prove himself. Prove you're the Son of God. Don't wait for God. Do it yourself. How does Jesus respond? He quotes the Bible, and he shows the devil that his spiritual needs are more important than his physical ones, that he values his relationship with God over a quick indulgence of carbs. The physical can wait, because by taking things into his own hands, by turning these stones into bread, which he could have very easily done, he instantly would have been demonstrating a lack of trust that God can provide. It's like how parents provide for their kids. It's like innately in parents to provide for their children, to want them to grow up and be excellent, but also to feed them and to tidy their bedrooms and to cook for them. My parents are incredible. They live in the UK. But when they come to see us in Malaysia, Even though I'm 24, I've been married for a while, and I don't live with them anymore, they just go straight back into parent mode. This is a picture of what happens when they come. They just start to clean our apartment. And that may be my feet up enjoying them cleaning. Your Heavenly Father wants to provide for your needs. But more than that, He wants to partner with you in doing it. The temptation for us is to not rely on God. Working hard is good, doing things well is good, but the desire to stand in our own two feet independently can sometimes become the source of our identity. The temptation is to rely on yourself to get good grades, to get a good career, to be in a relationship, to have a really stylish home. And when these needs are elevated to the top of your priority list, it means you don't feel the need to rely on God. And even more than that, you don't feel the need to include Him in your life. Then we miss out on the joy when God provides for us. Jesus said, "It takes more than bread to stay alive. It takes a steady stream of words from God's mouth." We have a friend here on the worship team. I'm not going to name her, but we call her the walking travel guide. If you're going to a new city or a new place around Malaysia or a new country, you can guarantee she will have been there before you. And she will tell you what restaurants to go to, what tourist attractions to go to, how to make the most of your short stay. She also will tell you what to avoid, where to shop, what time of year to go. Everything is recorded and she emails it to you on a spreadsheet. Yeah. And it's because she's been there before us. Jesus knew that we would face temptation. So when He Himself is facing temptation, He doesn't zap away the devil or call down legions of angels in like a Harry Potter battle. No, He resists temptation in a way that we can as well. He uses the Bible. Although when Jesus is using the Bible here, He's quoting from the book of Deuteronomy. I would not like to be depending on what I'd memorized from the book of Deuteronomy to fight my way through temptations. The great thing about Christianity is not for the spiritually elite. We use the Bible to resist temptation and to quote verses of scripture, but they're not incantations against temptations. It's to remind us and communicate to us the truth. And I think this is a huge thing to take away. Jesus, at His weakest, at His most vulnerable, uses the Bible. And we can too. It's our sword in the fight. It's undebatable truth, the Bible. And I don't know if you've heard of the Bible in 1 year. It's an app. It's also online. But they've recorded every single passage of the Bible and they've broken it down day by day for you to listen to. You don't even have to read it. And then after you listen to it, someone explains what it means to you. Like it's just amazing. And all you have to do is press play and you'll be equipped with so much truth. Okay, that was temptation one. Jesus has got through. He has recited scripture back to the devil in order to strengthen Himself. And the next temptation, the devil takes him to a really high point in the temple. Verse 6. Then again, he says, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, He will command His angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against stone." Jesus replies, "It's also written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." School holidays. Do you remember that feeling as a kid when you didn't have to go back to school for like a month? Amazing. My family and I used to go to France and we went to this beautiful town with this massive carousel that played music, had a big flowing river. We ate ice cream every day and it had an amazing, magnificent toy shop, like Disneyland in a room toy shop. It was unbelievable. And my brother and I got pocket money, so we were allowed to go and buy ourselves one treat on our holiday. And there was this one year, I remember, we like sprinted into the toy shop of dreams, and my brother immediately found a helicopter that actually flew, like a toy helicopter that actually flew. But he didn't have enough pocket money to cover it. And as any kid would, he completely threw a tantrum. He was on the floor, he was crying in front of this like massive store full of people, and my parents were so embarrassed. So I, as the little sister, saw an opportunity here. And I waited for my brother to keep screaming and whatever. And I waited for my parents to be able to see and hear me. And I said to my brother, Adam, you take my pocket money. I don't need anything anyway. It's okay, you have it. And he did. And then my brother went and he bought his toy helicopter. And I was counting down the seconds for my parents to say, oh, Abby, you're so wonderful and you're so kind and generous to your brother. So sacrificial. Why don't you reward yourself by buying anything in the shop and we'll get it for you. You deserve it. This is not what happened. My parents did not buy into my manipulation, and I was not rewarded for giving away my pocket money. So we just walked out of the shop. My brother so happy with his stupid helicopter, and me empty-handed and really annoyed. We've all had that moment with God. God, if I do this, then you owe me one. God, please just help me in this exam, and then like I'll follow you forever. Or please get our kids into this school and we'll start going to church. Jesus says, do not test the Lord your God. But the devil says, test him and he'll save you. In our alpha group a few weeks ago, we were talking about this. It's so hard to give up control, even to God, because we like to think we're going to know all the outcomes and that we have some control over the situation. And if needs be, we will bargain our way there and we will gently force God's hand to what we want. The devil wants Jesus to take control, to be spectacular and show all his power. Picture it. Jesus, he's at the top of the temple. It just sounds like the perfect plan. Everyone he's trying to convince is down below. And this way, he wouldn't have to go through a difficult ministry. He wouldn't be rejected by everyone. He wouldn't have to die on the cross. You know when people say they need that lightning bolt moment in the sky? This would have been it. Legions of angels dramatically saving Jesus in the middle of the temple. You don't need much more evidence than that. So why did Jesus not do it? Why did he not take the shortcut? The biggest way we are challenged in this temptation is we can have the tendency to live like, yeah, I'll just live my life, you know, God loves me and I'll pray sometimes and whatever. Or we can live in a way that actually only a miracle of God will save you. Faith is trusting, not testing. God asks us to live wisely, so we have a responsibility. It's like being in a relationship you know is foolish and expecting God to change the other person, or taking a job that you know your convictions are going to be really challenged, or hanging out with that group of friends that your conscience really struggles with. Our identity as God's children means that our calling is directed. Giving up control is vulnerable, but when you have a relationship with your Heavenly Father, when you're walking with him step by step by step and inviting him into your day and reading the Bible, then that means you know his voice. It means you can live wisely. Temptation number three. This is the last one. Let's read it together. Verses 8 to 10. Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. All this I will give you, he said, if you bow down and worship me. Jesus said to him, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, 'Worship the Lord your God and serve him only.'" This is the final temptation. This is the last hurdle before Jesus can get on and start his ministry. And the temptation is to gain all the earth's kingdoms and all of their splendor. And it's just one simple act. Bow down and worship the devil. But we know that the devil comes to steal, to kill, and destroy. And if Jesus had worshipped at this point, it would have meant that he sinned, and it would have gone against his identity as God's son. But more than that, it would have meant he would have been unable to fulfill the calling that was placed on his life. He would no longer have been able to be the bridge between us and God, because God needed a sinless sacrifice. Our identity and our calling are intrinsically linked. We are God's children. We are made to worship him. And that means that our calling isn't boxed in to doing certain things. The goal isn't necessarily to give everything up and become a monk, although you can do that if you want to. God wants to use our everyday living because he has incredible plans for your life where you are now. Hands up if you use WhatsApp. If not ever, come on, you all use WhatsApp, right? You know group chats? Oh, I think I get added to one every single day in this country. Well, you know when you've left your phone on airplane mode, or maybe you've been in a meeting and you come out and you check your phone and there's one group that have been having a full conversation and you have like 77 messages to catch up on and they all download at once and you need to scroll through them all and catch up on everything that everyone's been talking about. God doesn't just download everything into our heads. He doesn't expect us to just catch up. Because what he has planned for us, he reveals it step by step by step. You can be excited for your life because you know your calling. At its root, Jesus says it in verse 10, "Worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Invite God into your everyday. That's worship. That's your calling. And the temptation is to be lured into thinking it's about all the kingdoms of the world and it's about all the splendor and all the success. Mother Teresa said, "I don't pray for success. I pray for faithfulness." And that's the biggest thing we learn from Jesus, to persevere through the difficulties and try to withstand temptation. Romans 5, verse 3-5 says this, and I love this. "Suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that's been given to us." Do you know your identity in Jesus? Have you asked God what your calling is? Ken Coster was here about a month ago, and he talked about know your why. And I totally agree, because sometimes I think we forget the why, we get confused trying to do the what, because we first need to know the who. Know your who, and it will inform your why. So to finish, the devil will try and trip you up, because he doesn't want you to worship God in everything that you do. And Jesus persevered through these temptations, through his ministry, and ultimately to his death. So now we have access to God. That's how much he loves you. And that means that he has great plans for you. All of this empowers you when someone speaks badly of you at work, your identity is not shaken. When your social media world is telling you everything you're not, and when sometimes you wake up and you don't even know who you are. Jesus has paved the way for you to see that in every circumstance, your identity is secure. Jesus has paved the way for you to know God. He's paved the way for us to use the Bible when times are really hard. And he's paved the way for you to know who you are so you get access to all the incredible plans God has for your life. Amen. Let's stand. We're going to pray. If you want to close your eyes and you can hold out your hands as a sign that you're, we're going to invite the Holy Spirit here and that you welcome him. Lord, we thank you so much. We thank you that you sent Jesus, that you have paved the way for us, that you call us your children. And Lord, I pray right now you'll be revealing to each of us our callings and the exciting plans you have for our lives. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.